Hello and welcome again to our lecture course on relativity and cosmology. So we have discussed the Friedmann-Lemaître equation in general, and then I made an excurse to something of observational relevance, namely the distance measures that you need in order to have a quantitative derivation of Hubble's law and the corrections for higher redshifts. So we have seen that Hubble's law only is found for very small z, but that you have, and only then can be interpreted in terms of a Doppler shift, a hypothetical Doppler shift. But if you go beyond, and then certainly it has a different interpretation. It's an expression of the kinematics of the space-time geometry. Now we are going back to the Friedmann-Lemaître equations and look for solutions. So we look for the temporal evolution of the scale factor, and I will first discuss the case for lambda equals zero, for cosmological constant equals zero. As you know, and as I will emphasize again, today's universe is perfectly described by non-vanishing lambda. So for the present universe, of course, lambda is important, but nevertheless, for various reasons, it's good to have first an idea about the behavior for lambda equals zero. I mean, one reason is just historic, because in most of the time in the history of modern cosmology, lambda was neglected. So to understand that literature, of course, it's good to know the solutions for lambda equals zero. Then second, of course, these solutions are simpler and you get an idea about the possibilities. And the third, I mean, there was a time in the past when, as you will see, lambda, the lambda term was subdominant, and the universe or the evolution of the universe can be described without lambda. So all of this reason speak in favor of treating this case separately. And of course, if we include lambda, then you have to wait until the final section of this summer term. So in 12.8, we will make an excursus on the notion of horizons in cosmology. That will be next time. And then in the last lecture, we will go back and discuss the temporal evolution for lambda non-vanishing. And even in a general situation, where we speak of dark energy. But this you will learn in 12.9. No, so we had rewritten part of the Friedmann-Lemaître equation in this very suggestive form. The sum of all omegas is 1. So omega of times omega plus omega lambda plus omega k is equal to 1. So this curvature contribution is minus k over scale factor squared, Hubble parameter squared. And k, recall, can assume the values 0, flat, plus 1, spherical, minus 1, hyperbolic. Now we set omega lambda equals to 0 here. So we find from this that omega is omega minus k over a squared h squared is equal to 1. No? So that's what we have addressed. So just to remind you, what are the omegas? They are the ratio between a density and the so-called critical density. No? So omega is rho over rho critical. And rho critical is 3h squared over 8 pi g. Now, if we evaluate this today, we attach suffixes 0 to that. So evaluated today, we have omega naught minus k over a naught squared h naught squared is equal to 1. Or you can rewrite this in the suggestive way, where you directly see the connection between the curvature parameter and the omega. I mean, this can be written as k is equal to a naught squared h naught squared times omega naught minus 1. Now, recall from this Now we directly see that the sine of k is related to whether omega naught is equal to 1, bigger than 1, or smaller than 1. No? So that's a very nice relation that gives you the connection between something that has to do with the matter content of the universe, density over critical, and something that has to do with the geometry of the universe. They are not independent, and they are connected by this. Now the omega naught is the sum of all contributions that we have. I mean, radiation, matter, ordinary matter, which is dust, or maybe some exotic matter. This is why we often write omega naught as omega matter plus omega radiation. I don't consider here exotic, non-observed contributions. So this is usually just referred as matter. I should say it's more probably called dust. Pressure equals zero, and this is here the contribution from the radiation. Now, as you know today, the contribution from radiation, which is the contribution from the basically the cosmic microwave background, is negligible compared to this. So this is roughly equal to the matter contribution. No? So, and this is why we in fact have here, can assume that the pressure is zero, because that of course has a pressure rho over 3, but it is only contribution 10 to the minus 4 or something which we can neglect. The Friedmann-Lemaître equation, if I rewrite it in the old form, not in the omega form, with the one of those two equations, the one with the first derivative, which gives you an expression for a dot squared, is 8 pi g times rho over 3 a squared minus k. And the k, of course, is I will actually take from here and insert this here, so I can substitute this by this expression. I divide by a naught squared, so then the left hand side is a dot over a naught squared is equal to 8 pi g over 3. The rho, the density for the matter universe, we have already determined. So we had this third equation, rho dot plus 3h, rho plus p equals 0. And for this, we get a Newtonian expression in the sense that rho is proportional 1 over a cube. It's just a dilution of the density. So we can write this as rho naught times a naught over a cube. I mean, this is our rho. And then we have here a over a naught squared, because we divide this through, and then we substitute this here and divide by a naught squared. So we have here minus h naught squared omega naught minus 1. That's how we rewrote it. You will see soon why we did that. Now we use this expression for the critical density to substitute here for that term 8 pi g over 3. So we use 8 pi g over 3 is h naught squared times 1 over rho c comma 0. Now evaluate this expression here, evaluated today. So we get here a dot over a naught squared is h naught squared times 1 minus omega naught plus omega naught times a naught over a. Now putting this in front of the parenthesis, substituting this and using the definition for omega, and then you can have this equation. Now this is almost dimensionless. To make it fully dimensionless, I can have, or at least, I mean, except for the time and for the Hubble scale, I introduce x as the ratio between a and a naught, because as I emphasized earlier, I mean, for the scale factors, because it gives you the scale only, we do never know the absolute value of it. And so it makes sense here to refer to the present value as a reference. And because we can also then directly relate this with the redshift z that we observed. So we have a source, a galaxy, and we observe the redshift from the spectral lines. And the light was emitted at an earlier time when the universe was smaller and had a scale factor a, and it reaches us today when the scale factor is a naught. So we can have then here x dot squared is h naught squared times 1 minus omega naught plus omega naught over x. So you see everything now is related to today's value. Now we can use this equation for many purposes. One is to find the time. For example, the age of the universe, a hypothetical universe that was matter dominated all the time. Yeah, I should say, and you will see in section 12.9, of course, if I have here the lambda term, then what the only difference here will be we have an additional potential proportional to x squared, which is the harmonic oscillator potential. Here you have the Coulomb potential, so you see all the old friends, Coulomb and harmonic oscillator will appear here. No? So that's what we neglect here. Then just things are more complicated. But if we assume the matter-dominated universe, then if you integrate, then you get here for the time, t naught minus some initial time is h naught to the minus 1, and we have integral from x star to 1 dx tilde 1 minus omega naught plus omega naught over x tilde minus 1 half. No, I mean, it's just here when you write this at d over dx, dx over dt squared, and taking the square root and separate variables, then you can integrate. So that would be the age of a matter-dominated universe from some earlier time, t star, when the universe had that relative size, to today. So, and later for the real universe, we will have here one extra term, but that's the idea. So t, so let me call that star. So t minus t star, so that's the age of a matter-dominated universe from an earlier time, t star, up to today. Of course, if the universe had been matter-dominated all the time back to the Big Bang, then you could take this to be zero, but that's not what is true. Now, in that general case, of course, you have here the cosmological term and also the radiation term for the early universe. Now let us have a look at some special solutions. So special solutions for A of t and p equals zero for that matter domination. And let us distinguish between the three cases for k, 0, plus and minus 1. So the simplest is, of course, k equals 0. Now for k equals 0, you see that omega is equal 1. Well, I mean, this relation holds for all times. You just have to skip this index 0. So this means k equals 0, you have omega equals 1 all the time. And today you have omega not equal 1. So here we have omega equal 1, that is rho is equal to the critical density at all times. So this would is then called a fixed point. And you have then from here this expression here. I mean, you see here, this is 0 and this here is 1. So from this you have that a dot over a squared is h naught squared times a naught over a. Now that's of course a very simple equation and you can immediately integrate it. So from this you get the solution. Just separate the variables a and t, and we have a of t is a naught times 3/2 h naught times t over 2/3. No? A very simple expansion law. The universe expands. No? If you have just matter, just dust, and it expands in time with that power law t to the 2/3. I mean, the k equals 0 universe. No? So that's what we have to recall. So a of t is proportional t to the 2/3. Now, this solution was actually found and discussed further by Einstein himself together with de Sitter in 1932, and therefore it's called the Einstein de Sitter universe, well, sometimes the acronym EDS is used, and so this is a short article by Einstein and de Sitter 1932. It's different from what is called the Sitter universe, which I mentioned in 12.9, and which is more important than this solution. But that's, I think, one of the first solutions that you can write down and discuss, and it's a kind of prototype solution where you can discuss many things, even if that model is no longer realistic or is not realistic at all. So, I mean, for the EDS universe, if we continue here, then we can calculate Hubble parameter densities and so on. No, H is A dot over A, and if you insert that here, you see if you calculate A dot over A, it gives you 1 over T, and so you can express it as 2 over 3 times T. No, H has dimension of 1 over time, or you can take the inverse, which is the so-called Hubble distance, which is 3/2 times t, or c times t, if you introduce the speed of light. Now the density rho of t is rho naught times a naught over a cube, and if you insert here our result for a, then we get here, this is 4 O naught over 9 H naught squared T squared. And if we recall that the density today is the same as the critical density today, so it's always the critical density. Of course, the density changes, but it's at any time equal to the critical density at that time. You get here 1 over 6 pi g times t squared. So you see the density decreases, of course, if the universe expands, with the power 1 over time squared. The age of this hypothetical universe, age of the EDS universe, of course, you get here from this, if you set a equals a naught, no? So then this gives then 1, and you solve this with respect to t, then you get t, which is t naught, is 2/3 h naught minus 1. So you see, of course, that it's the only scale of time you have, h naught to the minus 1, And then you have, of course, a numerical factor, and this gives you then the time. But the time, or the age of that universe, is of the order of the Hubble time. This is why the Hubble time is sort of the first step for an estimate of the age. Now, if you now just for fun insert numbers, okay, this is an old solution, but if we insert what was found from the Planck satellite, which is just the small h not about 2/3, recall this is the Hubble constant in terms of 100 kilometers per second and megaparsec, then you get, if you just check, you get a T0 is around 9.9 giga years. Billion years. So is this realistic? Is it possible that the universe is that old? No, because we have many objects in the universe that we can observe, and some of them are very old, notably the globally clusters that are around our galaxy and all other galaxies, and they are older. Now, okay, many things may be unclear, But what is definitely the case is that there can be nothing in the universe older than the universe itself. So that's a very strict limit. So this is smaller than the age of globular clusters, which is of the order that what astronomers tell us by very detailed observations and theory of stellar evolution. They found this 12 giga years. So definitely, I mean, this does not fit. Yeah, even if you have errors, and so this does not fit. So this would mean that the ADS universe is in conflict with observations. This is how, I mean, this is a simple example, but this is how we shall always proceed in cosmology. Now, we have certain models from certain well-motivated equations, and we compare with observations, and many of those models can just be excluded from the data. And we will see in 12.9, I mean, what will remain? I mean, what is the best fit model of all those? Okay, that's the simplest case. So that's k equals 0. Now we still have to deal with k equals 1 and minus 1. And I will not go into such a detail in the calculations, but I give you basically the result. So the second is k equals plus 1. Now recall, this means that rho naught is bigger than the critical density. So we have omega naught bigger than 1. And if you check for the deceleration parameter, which I have not now calculated, but which is the minus a double dot times a squared over a dot squared, the dimensionless acceleration, it would correspond to this. And one can show, and of course you can then also check, if I give you the solution, one can show from the equations, it's also not very difficult here, from this, that the solutions are so-called cycloids that you, I hope you have encountered in mechanics. Now, if you have a wheel that processes and a point on the circumference, then gives you a cycloid. And yeah, and this mechanical solution reappears here in cosmology. So one can show that the solution curves for A of t are cycloids. And typically you give the cycloids in parameter representation because you cannot do it explicitly. So given in parametric representation by, and so we have a parameter that we call eta, and this parameter, as usual for cycloids, goes between 0 and 2 pi. And we give parametrically then A of eta and T of eta. Now, so the A of T you cannot give explicitly in a closed form, this with simple functions not, and a and t you can, but this you can give in simple elementary functions explicitly, and it turns out as a prefactor omega naught to h naught times omega naught minus 1 to the 3 half 1 minus cosine eta. And here we have omega naught over 2 h naught times omega naught minus 1 over 3 half. I mean, that's the same prefactor, but here you have then eta minus sine eta. So that's the solution here. And you can also write this in terms of the maximal value of A, I mean a cycloid, you know, as this form. So it has a maximum. So we define here the maximum over 2 times 1 minus cosine eta. You know? And you see this is reached for the value eta equals to pi. You know? Then here you have 1 plus 1, which cancels the 2. And so it starts with 0 and pi and then 2 pi. And of course you have this as a max over 2 eta minus sine eta. So that's then rather simply express the solution for k equals plus 1. So you see if you calculate dt over the eta, no, then you get here 1 minus cosine eta, you get directly then the a. And if you recall from our section on the cosmological redshift, where we had introduced also an eta, this was called the conformal time, and it's just defined by this relation. So eta, in fact, is already something known to you. It's a different time parameter, and in relativity, we can use whatever time parameter pleases us for our purposes. And here it's the eta, so eta is the conformal time. Conformal because the line element has this form dA squared is a squared of eta times something. So the a squared is put in front. Yeah, so again, I mean, the giving a small diagram. So we have here then, if we plot a of t against t, now not eta, so we have here the cycloid that looks like that. I mean, one branch, of course, we don't know what it means to continue that. So we talk about one part. It's not like with the wheel, it's rotating wheel. So we have here the time equals zero, and here then the maximal time. And we have here a max. So this here is often called the Big Bang. Yeah, I mean it's not consistently used, this term. Originally, the term means just the early radiation-dominated phase. That's how it was introduced in the 1950s, actually as a not so nice description of that model. But nowadays, many physicists call this time zero the Big Bang also. So it's not consistently used. And here you see this universe model has a maximum and recollapses, so different from the Einstein de Sitter universe, which expands forever. And this we call the Big Crunch, in analogy to that. Or you could perhaps better call it the initial singularity and the final singularity, because actually there are singularities in the equations as we have generally discussed earlier. So this is a model for an expanding and recollapsing universe. And it was taken very seriously for a very long time in the history of modern cosmology as really an option. We have to see whether it's still an option. Now, I mean, this A max here, I mean, if I just copy from here, that's omega naught over H naught times omega naught minus 1 to the 3 halfness. You see, you can, if you were sure that this model described our universe, you could directly determine, I mean, the maximal value from observations. So here, for example, you can also introduce our k, which is 1, as a naught squared, h naught squared over omega naught minus 1. I mean, this relation that we had earlier, this one. And so we can directly write this as a naught times omega naught to omega naught minus 1. No, so very simple formula. So you know, if you can measure omega today, which is density, our critical density, you just have to insert this, and then you can calculate how big the universe will become in the future. For example, if we measured, and this is not what we measure, but on paper you can assume if we had this value, it could be, it's a possible universe, then a max would be here just twice a naught. Yeah? So if you measure this, then you would conclude, our universe will expand further, but up only to twice the size it has. I mean, this in length, in radius, the size. And so a max is reached when, okay, you have to look here for that formula T of a max. I mean, this is reached when eta is equal to pi. No, this is eta to pi is reached at T of a max. So you insert eta equals to pi and you get pi over 2 times a max, or if you introduce speed of light, it's pi a max over 2c. That would be the time of that universe, at the age of that universe, when you reach a max. And so you can just again insert here values to get some fictitious numbers. The age of this model universe generally would be as follows. So the age of this model universe would be, no, so recall we have omega is equal to omega m, is just a matter-dominated universe, and so from our formula here, no, you can see, I mean, that's that formula here. We just have to have here, if we calculate the time from the Big Bang, we have to have here 0 as the lower limit of that integral. So we have here T naught, today's the age of the universe. Of course, the dimensions are in the Hubble parameter, and then you have a dimensionless integral that reads as follows. 1 minus omega naught plus omega naught over x tilde minus 1 half. This is an elementary integral. You can look up in the tables or you can calculate it just as an exercise. But the result is the following. Omega naught over 2 h naught omega naught minus 1 to the 3 half. And then you have the inverse cosine, arcus cosinus 2 over omega naught minus 1, minus 2 over omega naught. Then you have here omega naught minus 1 to the 1 half. Okay, this looks not so simple as here the expression in the Einstein Theta universe, but you can play a little bit around with it and you can convince yourself, which I leave as a small exercise, that this is smaller than 2/3 h naught to the minus 1. So that was the h of the De Sitter universe, of the Einstein De Sitter universe, and which was already too young to be a viable model of the universe. Now this model is even has even a shorter time. So if the EDS is excluded, I mean this model is excluded even more. No? So it means the h is smaller than the h of the corresponding EDS universe. So it's observationally even more excluded. Now you can intuitively understand why it has a shorter h, even if you don't make the estimate correctly, because man, this is a recollapsing model, so it's decelerated more than the k equals zero. No? It has more matter, so it's decelerated more. So if you look back to the Big Bang and into the past, it's more accelerated, and so it has a shorter time. If you look back in the past, so it's a shorter h than the k equals zero. I mean, you can calculate for this model, if you like, also the deceleration parameter, which is, I mean, you just have to take this minus a double dot formula, and you find that this is 1 over 1 plus cosine eta. So we have that the q is between 1/2 and infinity, depending on the value of eta. Okay, so far for the k equals plus universe. Now the final one is the minus, k equals minus 1, and I again give you the result. I mean, you can perhaps anticipate what it is, because it would just change the sign here. Now we have here the minus 1, and then would mean this would correspond to omega naught smaller than 1, and in fact you can get a result by analytic continuation from these you just have, I mean, omega smaller than 1, so you get imaginary units I, and if you do this together with the cosine, you get a hyperbolic cosine and a hyperbolic sine. Okay, so we have derived, given you the result, the solution for k equals plus 1, where you have this cycloid, the expanding and recollapsing universe. So the last option is we have this k equals minus universe. And for this, I mean, the density is smaller than the critical density, which means that omega naught is smaller than 1. And q naught is smaller than 1/2. As I said, the solution, of course, you can derive directly, but you can take this result from k equals plus 1 and analytically continue, from omega bigger than 1 to omega minus 1. So you have here these square roots. You get imaginary units here. So the solution follows from the k equals plus 1 solution by analytic continuation. So this means that you can, if you send eta to minus I eta, then you get the corresponding solution for k equals minus 1, as you can directly check yourself. So we can write an a of eta is omega naught over 2 h naught times 1 minus omega naught to the 3/2 cos eta minus 1, and t of eta is omega naught over 2 h naught 1 minus omega naught to the 3/2. And you have the sinh eta minus eta, and the eta now is can run from 0 to infinity, not just from 0 to 2 pi. So we have here then eta is between 0 and infinity, the conformal time between 0 and infinity. And so that's a model that again starts with a big bang, with an initial singularity, followed by an eternal expansion. Yeah? So we have here then an eternal expansion. So, and if you look for, I mean, for large values of eta, then you see here that, I mean, the one here is neglected, and the eta is neglected, and the cosh and the sinh approach each other. So we have here for eta to infinity, we have a proportional to t. The h of this model universe, you can also write down, you can use our earlier expression for the closed universe, and again do the analytic continuation. So the h of this model universe, we have t naught, this h naught to the minus 1, you have 1 over 1 minus omega naught, minus omega naught over 2 times 1 minus omega naught over 3 over 2, area hyperbolic cosine 2 over minus 1. No? So that long expression. Again, you can try to estimate this compared to the earlier models. So you can check just with, looking at the behavior of this area cosine hyperbolic, and you find that the h of this is between that value and just the value 1 over h naught. Yeah. So, I mean, from this is what was already excluded here. I mean, this here could be marginally be in accordance with observation, this universe. This h over 1 over h naught, I mean, this is also a particular case. That's the h of the empty universe. Yeah. What is the empty universe? The empty universe is a universe that has no matter, no radiation in it, also no cosmological constant, just curvature. No? So we have here a dot squared is equal to minus k. That's the only term that remains. And you see, only for k equals minus 1 do you have a solution for an empty universe. No? That's here plus 1, which means that a of t is proportional to t, and that's also what I mean you find here asymptotically. But you could have an exact model of this type, an empty universe that has this expansion. That is, if you have test particles in it, even if there's nothing with which you can compare these test particles, they would recede each other with that law. Now, this is also known as the Milne universe. After the British astrophysicist Edward Milne, who presented this in his book of 1935. Of course, yeah, you can say that's very simple. Why does it get a particular name? But of course, you can discuss various geometric issues that is not visible here. And I mean, it has a part of that space-time can be identified with Minkowski space-time, but globally it has a different structure. So there is some, in a sense, pedagogical value to have this, and this is why it has a name. Although this has never been, I think even for Milne himself, never been, of course, understood as a realistic model of the universe, because it was obvious at all times that okay, an empty universe is not what should fit our real universe. But nevertheless, I mean, we explore options, we explore solutions of Einstein equations to get insight also in the possibilities that those equations contain. Back to this. So the H is bigger than the Einstein de Sitter universe H. And we can also give the deceleration parameter. It's in 1 over 1 plus hyperbolic cosine of eta. And it's between 0 and 1/2. But always positive. Now all these universes are decelerating. And summarizing the three, this gives a famous diagram. So if you look back in older cosmology books from the last century, then most of them did not treat the cosmological constants, so they presented these solutions as the options that you have. No? So you have here the closed case. So that's the k equals plus 1. Then you have, of course, the Einstein de Sitter universe that goes like that. So it asymptotes here the horizontal, so k equals 0, so asymptotes a dot to 0. Yeah, so that, and you have the negatively curved one that goes here, that asymptotes here a proportional to t. No? So asymptotes a proportional to t, and this is k equals minus 1. No? So you see here these three options. And so in earlier years, then people thought these were the only options. At that time, also, it was not so, the Hubble parameter was not so known precisely. So at that time, say a couple of decades ago, people could not yet say that this is excluded from observations, right? It depends on if the Hubble parameter, say, were bigger or smaller, then of course you would have a longer age of the universe. Say if H naught is much smaller, then the universe is older and can accommodate the globular clusters. Now, these three options, I mean, this is for a matter-dominated universe, which is the one or the only one that you can really compare with Newtonian cosmology because it just contains matter and it's diluted by 1 over volume. So you can directly here identify the analogy with Newtonian cosmology. So this corresponds to the three possibilities of Newtonian cosmology. So we have k equals plus 1, k equals 0, and k equals minus 1. And so this would correspond here to the negative energy of Newtonian cosmology. This here would correspond to the vanishing energy. And this here would correspond to the positive energy. Now, so we had here, if you recall, E over M in the effective Friedmann equation is minus K over 2. So we have this energy law, A dot squared is blah, blah, blah. And if you write this as 1/2 M A dot squared, then you can identify this Newtonian energy with these three values. But as I said, this is only formal. Newtonian cosmology has these forces that attract each other in a flat universe. Here it's a universe itself that has these dynamics. But because we have here a Friedmann-Lemaître universe just with matter, we can make here the closest possible analogies with Newtonian cosmology. Now from this, and also from the expressions we had earlier, we can calculate, I can use this here. We can calculate other issues of interest. So for example, the connection between emission time and redshift. time and redshift. I mean, it's again this one formula that I derived earlier today, which is x dot h naught square, 1 minus omega naught plus omega naught over x. Now recall x is a over a naught. And so the emission time, te, so that's here the te. So that's the te is the age of the universe at the time of the emission. So you have you observe some galaxy emits light at some earlier time, and that's the te. You can write as h naught to the minus 1, and you again have the integral from 0. And here, I mean, that's of course not today, so it's not 1. We can now write, if we introduce the redshift, 1 plus z to the minus 1 dy, and we have 1 minus omega naught plus omega naught over y to the minus 1 half. No? Of course, this is only true if the universe were matter-dominated or had been matter-dominated all the time. So to be more precise, that would the lower limit would be the time of validity of p equals 0 in the past. And so we have here, I mean, the relation 1 plus z to the minus 1 is a of te over a naught. So you could also then have the look-back time. The look-back time, which is t naught minus te, right? I mean, that's the age of the universe today. That's the emission time. So that's the time it takes, I mean, between the emission event in that galaxy, what we see, and today. That's called the look-back time. And you can calculate this. Of course, in general, you have a bit more complicated expression. But to give you a simple expression for the end of today's lectures, so for example, if we go back to the Einstein de Sitter universe, where we have q equals to 1/2, then we have here t naught minus te is t naught minus h naught to the minus 1, integral from 0 to 1 plus z to the minus 1 dy square root of y. And this is, of course, a very simple integral. You can also have a more complicated situation. So this gives you 2/3 h naught to the minus 1 minus 2/3 h naught to the minus 1, 1 plus z to the minus 3/2. Or if you put this here in front of the parenthesis, I mean, which is the age of the Einstein de Sitter universe, then you have here 1 minus 1 over 1 plus z to the 3/2. Now, okay, that's the simplest possible example, but you see already in this example, I mean, the merit of this, so you can calculate the time of propagation directly in terms of the redshift that you observe. And if you have the k equals plus 1 or minus 1 model, then, okay, you have either a smaller for the positive case or a larger for the negative case of look-back times. In general, these things are evaluated numerically if you have a complicated model with also lambda and radiation, but it's all based on these equations. And you see here how, in principle, this we proceed. Okay, that's all for today and for this section of temporal evolution for lambda equals 0. So, as I said, there are two sections left for this summer term. In 12.8, I discuss an important notion, the horizon. Now, you know the horizon, of course, from the black hole case, which gives you limits of causal connection. And this is not restricted to black holes. It applies to many fields of relativity, in particular to cosmology. But in cosmology, there are different notions of horizons are used, not only the event horizon, but also so-called particle horizon. And I have to introduce that. And in that connection, we will discuss again the observational situation today. And in 12.9, finally, we will come back here to discussing a of t, but for the case lambda non-vanishing, there we have to distinguish cases between positive lambda, negative lambda, and so this gives us much more options, and we will then finally find the curve a of t for the model that fits best of our universe. So stay tuned. Thanks for today, and until next time.